I want you to turn in your Bible to Isaiah chapter 61. Isaiah chapter 61. The book is there called The Assignment, and some of you have already planted your seed of $100 and taken yours home. Some of you have given $100 several times and took several home. And that's sure smart. Somebody asked me, how long did it take you to write this book? 62 years. 62 years. And it's full of material. Turn to Isaiah chapter 61. I've got a very unique picture today to share with you. We've been on their assignment. I believe that the assignment is one of the three most important things in your life. Thank you, brother. You may be seated there, our photographer. Thank you. We're okay. I'm okay now. Thank you. It is very important to know that your assignment is unique. It's different. What you see, nobody else sees. What you feel stirred to do, nobody else feels stirred. Your assignment is your point of distinction from another. What makes you unlike another person is not your nationality, not your gender, not your sex, not male nor female, not your skin color. Had a brother came up to me the other day, said, you know what I love about you? He said, you don't see color. Now I kept looking, I said, color, color, color. He said, skin, color, color. No, I don't, because that's not your difference. Your difference from everybody else is your assignment on the earth. Your difference from another is not your looks, not if you're a blackhead or blonde head or where you're skinny or tall, or your difference from others in your assignment. My pen does not do what my glasses do. My eyes do not hear. My ears do not speak. You must find your assignment. Your assignment begins, believe it or not, in the heart of God, in your mother's womb, Jeremiah 1. God decided in your mother's womb what he wanted you to become, what he wanted you to do, the problem he wanted you to solve. We have emphasized over and over the importance of your assignment. It's the only place money is waiting for you. Money is not just anywhere for you. Money is wherever God wants you to be. Money is a verification of where God wants you to be. If God sends you to the brook, the provision will be there. If he sends you to Zarephath, the provision is there. Your assignment is always to a person or a people. If your name is Moses, your assignment's to the Israelites. If your name is Aaron, your assignment's to Moses. How do you know your assignment? Whose tears affect you? Whose success matters to you? Whose enemies are you willing to confront? Who do you want to protect? Whose pain do you feel? You must go through seasons of preparation for your assignment. You're not born qualified, you become qualified. Your assignment determines what you're willing to ignore. Your assignment magnifies a problem that you see. Now, it's hard to imagine, and no one gets mad at the Chinese place for not selling hot dogs, because we've accepted their assignment. We don't drive up to Der Wiener Schnitzel and say, I'd like to see some sofas. We're really wanting some sofas. We don't sit there and slap somebody and say, what do you mean all you have is hot dogs? No, we want a sofa. So we've accepted, and they even advertise their assignment. They'll have a picture of a hot dog out there, and this is what we do. There's one piano store that has a piano in the air, a huge grand piano. We're a music store. They want you to know their assignment. This is what we do. Well, in your individual life, that's what God wants to do. He wants you to know your assignment. When I was a young preacher, I got mad at Billy Graham for never having a prayer line. And I was stunned. How could a man with 100,000 people in front of him and many people sick and never have a prayer line? That wasn't his assignment. You want to unclutter your life of anything that's not your assignment. And if you're not where you're assigned, you are in preparation for your assignment. You must perform well where you are. Get so good at where you are. I told a young preacher one time that worked with me, I said, son, the ministry is a lot more than 30 minutes of rah-rah in the pulpit. There's a whole lot to ministry. He didn't want to do anything but just preach. Praise God, hallelujah, preach. No, I don't want to learn the computer. No, I don't want to have to keep a schedule. No, I don't want to learn time management. No, I hallelujah. Well, that's just a part of the assignment. So we want, my goal here is to nurture in you a consciousness of your difference. A consciousness of what God's put inside you, because something he has put inside of you is what he anoints. He works with himself in you. Always God does work with the God in you. And his gifts from him are placed in you, and that's what he anoints. You don't see Billy Graham trying to play a violin on the platform. That's not his assignment. So we want to make you conscious of your assignment. Look at Isaiah chapter 61. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me. Say that with me. He hath sent me. Say it again. Say it about three times. I want you to become so aware that your assignment is from the Lord. It's not from your parents. Your parents may wish you was a dentist. Or why don't you get a real job? Your assignment comes from the Lord. You discover it. You don't decide your assignment, you discover it. The questions you ask determine how swiftly you discern your assignment. It was only 25 years ago or so that I discovered the center of my assignment. I preached all over the world, and I had a guy come to spend some time with me 5 days, and he interrogated me constantly. He said, you sing songs, you write music, you play the piano, you go to over to Africa, you go to churches, you have little success seminars in the Disneyland Hotel every month, and you're on TV, you're on the radio every day. What do you do? What are you about? And he began to interrogate me and quiz me and question, because it did look a little stupid. If you came to a success seminar, one of my sessions had a lady teaching people how to dress. Another one taught people protocol. Had another lawyer teaching things about law. One of my seminars, I'd have realtors to teach how to buy a house. I thought, well, I guess, you know, to go from the cross and the blood to money is quite a leap for some people. It's a jump. So he had some good questions. And through his interrogation of me, and kept asking me, and kept quizzing me, kept asking, what are you about? Finally, I said, well, you know, wisdom, that's what I'm about. I want to learn. I want understanding. Then that's what I'm about, everything. And I remember then Marilyn Hickey telling me one day, she said, you know, every time you open your mouth, you teach. She said, you can't even sing a song without teaching in your song. She said, has it ever dawned on you that even your songs are teaching? No. Someday you'll believe someone. And that day will decide what you become the rest of. Every word you've ever heard will grow like a seed over time. And the words that you... just teaching. Teaching. I'd never seen myself as a teacher. Those days, we didn't know what the word mentorship, that was not a big thing. As he questioned me, I began to realize that's what I was. I couldn't, what makes a man study 12, 14, 16? I hate to turn off the light at night. Too much to learn on the earth. Too much to know on the earth. Oh, I want to learn. Your assignment is what you never get tired of doing. When you're in the center of your assignment, you hate for it to stop. I've taught many 12-hour days. I was in England some time ago. We ran from one to another to 12 nonstop hours. 12 nonstop hours. No meals, no nothing. And when I got through, I thought, this is nuts. Except that I like it. Everybody else, you know, some of them grown old. We had people become grandparents while I was teaching it and so on. And I knew that the length of the teaching was wretched. It was horrible. Nobody wants a message past 22 minutes. I ought to know that from Ed Young. But something inside me wants to keep teaching. I can't quit learning, and I can't. So your assignment is what you would do if there was no money in it. It's what you would do if you were doing it for free. If everybody on the earth made $10 an hour, no matter what you did, what you would choose to do if there was no money involved, that's the assignment. If anybody comes to work for me, one of the first questions I say is, how low a salary are you willing to accept to start to impress me? I want to know the lowest salary you're willing to accept. In 90 days, I'll evaluate you. I've given people far more than they asked for. But I want to know how much you're willing to start, because that gives me a picture of the love, the passion they have. Your assignment is so important because it's the key to everything else you're wanting. Your joy, your peace, your sense of significance. That's where it comes from. If you say, well, I need somebody to tell me I'm important. What if they do that and next week they decide you're not? Yank. Now you're a hostage to their opinion. I've had people think, oh, you changed my life next month. So your assignment is an unending resource for self-confidence. You won't have self-confidence if you're not in the middle of what you are called to do, assigned. Now, I'm going to take you on a little visit. It's going to be powerful because it's been in my spirit. Let me give you some wisdom keys from the book. And you want to run those through for a few. You want to show some of them on the screen. Number one, chapter one. You ready? Chapter one. Say it out loud. Everything God created was created to solve a problem. We've talked to you about the importance of problems. Without a problem, you won't have friendships, because for the only reason there's friends is you solve a problem. When you stop solving a problem in a friendship, the friendship dies. It may be emotional, spiritual, fun, energy, kind. It doesn't make any difference. Problems keep people together. Problems decide your worth. You will be paid proportionate to the problem you solve. Two brothers can work at the same company, but if they solve two different kinds of problems, it changes everything. Problems decide your value. Problems are important because problems are the factory for the reward system on the earth. And there is a reward system on the earth, and the reward system is based on the problem you solve. Now, if you create a problem, your value goes down. Number two, chapter two. You are a reward to someone. Say that with me. You are a reward to someone. Not everyone. Some people don't enjoy you. Some people feel no difference in your presence. Some people do not consider you an asset at all. Should that make you mad? No, you're not assigned to them. Pastor Howard Houghton has a powerful book. You've got to read his book. It's astounding. But the Lord dealt with him not to chase people down to make them come hear him teach. God gave him a peace that those who did not hear the message that he had for them and saw no value in it, he was not assigned to them. Notice that the father did not chase down the prodigal son. It was the responsibility of the prodigal son to discern the distinction and the importance of the father. I get very concerned when people come two or three Sundays and quit and leave out two or three weeks. I get troubled. I get stirred. What's wrong? What's happened? But I have to come back to this. Wait. They are not here because they do not consider me a reward. They don't come Sunday morning. They don't consider me a reward. Should I get upset? No. Maybe they wouldn't be a reward in my life. It may not be just God protecting them. It may be God protecting me, keeping them out of my environment. Oh, yeah, when God wants to bless you, he removes somebody. Three, your assignment is not your decision, but your discovery. I didn't decide to be a preacher, a teacher. It's what I discovered I am. You don't decide what you are. You discover who God made you. Look at number four. What you hate, chapter four. Let's say it together. What you hate is a clue to something you are assigned to correct. Now that's very strong. Hatred is energy. Hatred, anger, is passion. Well, Brother Mike, I don't think we should be mad. Well, discuss that with God. He looks like he's mad most of the time. So anger is energy requiring an appropriate focus. Pay attention to what makes you mad, because you can only conquer something you hate. If you hate injustice, you may be an attorney, a lawyer. If you have a hatred of disease and sickness, you may be called to be a doctor, a physician. If you have a hatred of child abuse, it's possible God wants you to have a special home. The woman who saw her baby splattered on a pavement, her only son, because of a drunk driver, became so angry, so embittered, so hurt, she launched a company, an organization called MADD, M-A-D-D, Mothers Against Drunk Driving. And she saved thousands of lives. Your anger is an asset, and your anger is a reward to somebody. See, I have a hatred of ignorance. I have a hatred of a lot of things, but I have a special hatred of poverty. I don't like being broke. I don't see God in it. I don't see humility in it. Some of the proudest people I know are broke. So poverty doesn't make you humble. I have a hatred of poverty. But if you've got people who have publicly said you made a millionaires, which we have. I think we're 18 millionaires right now. We've asked God to raise up 300 millionaires. We have 18 so far. Now, I'm a reward to somebody who hates poverty. Clues, keys. Now, try to use that anger that you have. It was someone who hated ugly who invented makeup. Beauty is the only cure for makeup or for ugly. I sat down some time ago in the Benny Hinn's TV. His TV lady was putting on some makeup on me. And I said, makeup is the proof you can improve on God and what he's done. Anger is energy. Anger is the birthplace for creativity. Anger makes you creative. What is it that you hate? What is it that infuriates you? Really be attentive to your anger. I've been very angry over ineffective working, people not following instruction. And for a long time, I thought, well, this is something I got to get over. Maybe I'm not even called to have anybody work for me. Maybe I should just be alone on the earth. And I mean, seriously, because I felt like I was going to, like Moses, you know, and miss all of Canaan because I got mad at somebody not following my instruction. Because it's very hard to find anybody who will follow instructions. It's very, very hard. I've never had an armor bearer in my life who would ever buy a map. Never. Never had one. First thing I do when I hired somebody, I couldn't find, to this day, I hadn't found one person who will travel with me who will buy a map. What is it? I think it's a spirit. And I've done everything but cuss, and inside half cussed. I have done everything I know to get them to buy a map, but no. They want to drive around for 2 hours. And then when I get so mad I can hardly stand anymore, then they stop and go into a store they've never been in their life and ask somebody they've never met how to go to a place they've never been. Look at someone next to you and say, he's still not healed from that, is he? He's still not healed. I need a driver. I need a driver right now. I need someone to take me places, go to places, travel, do that. I need it. But just that one quality seems to just baffle. I'll pay for the map. I will. I did have one time, I said, where's the map? It's in the trunk. We're driving, it's in the trunk. And I'm saying to myself, I have no business ever teaching on wisdom. I ain't got any. A man like me who'd hire somebody to live like this, how could you ever have the gall? Lord, how did I get off on that? What chapter was that? Anger. I was in my case presenting my justification for my anger. That's why. If we had an assignment seminar and could have biblical characters on the stage, what would they teach us about the assignment? Adam and Eve, come up here. Adam and Eve, the first humans, come up here. Tell me about the assignment. And Adam, the first human, could say, God brought us to a huge garden. It's gorgeous, beautiful, everything you could name. Let me name anything I wanted to. Told me to keep up the garden. He only said, there's one thing I had to do. Avoid tasting of that tree. I could eat any fruit from any tree. I could have everything I wanted. But all I had to do is say no to that fruit there. And I could keep this garden. I could be the king of this turf. And he said, I failed. I didn't follow the one instruction he gave me. He gave me a warning. Now you and I, I know you've puzzled by this. What an opportunity for God to show mercy. The first mistake a man makes, what a chance for God to show him, you missed it. Come on, let's do it again. Come on, let's try it again. Ow. Some mistakes are fatal. Some mistakes will cost you 20 years of joy. Every feeling has a price. Every feeling has a time frame. Every pleasure requires a deposit. Every pleasure is costly. Some cost a nickel, some cost 100,000, some cost millions. Every mistake has a different value. God did not let them come back into the garden. If Adam was here, he would say, even if it's one small thing, just follow. Now, I think he would say, follow the cotton picking instruction. That's what I think. Could be wrong. Joseph is up. Talk to us, Joseph, about your assignment. He'd say, well, God could show it to you in a dream at night, but he won't show it to your whole family. He'll just show it to you. Can you hear Joseph talking? He said, it won't happen quickly. When God puts a picture of your assignment, it can be for years ahead. He said, my role was to prepare for it. And the reason God gave me the picture of my assignment is so I could interpret the events around me as part of the divine equation to get me to the throne. Remember, and what he'd tell you is, don't tell all your dreams to everybody. He would say, you got to realize that Joseph had only one friend, his father, who was a deceiver.
I never tire of the wisdom of God. Wisdom is the ability to recognize difference, right and wrong, evil and righteousness, difference in people, difference in a countenance, difference in a moment, like the blind man crying out to Jesus. The dominant purpose for wisdom, and don't you love the wisdom of God? So thankful you're listening today and watching and being a part of the internet, telling others about it. And I hope you're getting, by the way, I hope you're getting my daily podcast every single day on your iPod or your MP3, every single day, 2 minutes of wisdom. Be a blessing. Sometimes I go a little over because I get excited. I want you to be a part of this ministry. I believe that when you get involved with God, He gets involved with you. I am one of the ministers of the gospel who believe the words of Jesus. I believe every word He said. When He told Peter that there would be a 100-fold return on any investment in the gospel, in Mark 10, 28 through 30, I believed Him. When the word of God says in Malachi 3, that if I bring the tithe, which is 10% of my income, and the offering back to Him, that He would open the windows of heaven and pour me out a blessing I don't have room enough to receive, I believe Him. Why would I believe God about heaven and hell and not believe Him about the blessing of the Lord? I want to pray over the seeds that you have been planting in this ministry. And by the way, I have an incredible gift you're going to love. In fact, it's probably one of the greatest gifts I've ever offered. We're asking the Holy Spirit for 300 partners this week who will set aside a seed of $300 for our outreaches. I need your help. I want you to help me. Not just to feed 1,000 children a day, which we do, or 1,000 families, or underwrite the Wisdom of Asia Bible College, or to underwrite the tent factory in South Africa, or the Home of Hope, but that we can go into 100 countries with the gospel. I'm holding in my hand the Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. The Wisdom Quick Scan Bible. I have never in my life found a Bible easier to read. As you know, for many years, I've read the Bible through 40 chapters a day, every single month of my life. There is no easier book to read than this Quick Scan Bible. When I found out that I could offer it to you inside of some of the teaching that I've been doing and I'll do today, I want you to have it. Call me right now. Plant your seed of 300. and watch God move.
There wasn't one good human in Joseph's life. Not one. Not one person in his life who was believable. His father loved him, but didn't believe in his assignment. His father's affection for him was based on his father's need, not his recognition of difference in Joseph. Joseph was the child. He was the last baby, so he got a coat of many colors. But the father who loved him was the master of Slither. So Joseph would tell us today, you may be the only person who has the picture of your assignment. Don't tell everybody. Don't advertise it. Just embrace it, believe it, and start the journey to the throne. If Joseph was here talking to us, he would say, one of the secrets I found was not to get embittered after someone did me dirty. Those who write a book, "You Did Me Dirty," haven't been to a Joseph seminar. Because he would say, never talk like a victim. He said, you may feel like a victim. You may feel like nobody believes in you. You may believe that everybody has done you wrong. But he said, never let that enter your conversations. Keep your head up high. Minimize the mistakes you've made. Don't discuss it with everybody. Keep a good spirit. Don't advertise your flaws. And always know who your boss is. Know who your boss is. Joseph was a one-owner dog. Joseph was a one-owner dog. Remember in history, Josephus, the Jewish historian, said that Joseph was such a perfect specimen. History says he had the most perfect body of any male. And she would bring Joseph there, strip him, and she would use him for a party thing. All of her Potiphar's wives and her friends would gaze at Joseph for hours and discuss him. He was like their zoo. But he wouldn't go to bed with her. And he said, I work for your husband. I'm a one-owner dog. And he has given me everything but you. And I have a responsibility. Now, if she was ugly, it wasn't a lot for him to overcome. But if she was really outstanding, it might have taken, he might have prayed in tongues for 2 hours. Lord, just one time. Lord, this is your chance to make up for what happened to me. But he said, I'm a one-owner dog. When the king brought him in, the king discerned his difference. I think the proof of greatness is the ability to discern greatness. You will know the greatness of people by their discerning of your greatness. The king said, I want you to create a strategy that will get us through the famine. Oh, what did Joseph do? He didn't try to make deals with people underneath him. He had one goal, make my boss happy. Make my boss happy. I can tell you swiftly, on my staff, who's a one-owner dog. And I can tell you the ones that's trying to make my vendors happy. trying to make everybody happy, and I'm the last guy on the pole. Oh yeah, it's so easy to know. Joseph would tell you, whoever you're assigned to, whatever it takes, make it happen for them. Focus on them. Take on the whole world if necessary. Know who God has chosen to bless you. Let's visit Esther. Esther, talk to us about your assignment. She's gorgeous, the most beautiful woman in 126 provinces, 127 provinces. She's knockout. She's got poise. She had to soak in oil 2 6-month periods just to go to bed with the king. The king didn't look at her and say, oh, you're pretty, let's go to bed tonight. He said, oh, you're pretty. Soak in oil so I can take the smell off of you. I don't like where you've been. I want the odor of your past removed from my presence. I want yesterday gone from you. I don't want you to be an experience. I want you to be my life. If Esther was teaching us tonight, she'd say, pay the price to qualify for your assignment. Hallelujah. She would tell you your assignment will probably come to fruition in a crisis. When there's a Haman that wants to destroy, that will bond you with your king. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now, if Esther was here, she'd say, know how to talk to the king in your life. Don't get in his face. Prepare the environment for him to receive what you say. Never be corrective and combative with your king. Now, the king in Esther's life had made the most stupid, evil man in the province his best friend. Doesn't this make him look a little stupid? Haman gets to go and come. Haman has access to the king nobody else has. So she had every right to saunter in the king's chambers and said, you're making one of the most stupid decisions of your life. She had every right to say, I don't trust your discerning anymore. I can tell you don't recognize people. You don't know who's right and who's wrong. Do you know who's close to you? What kind of idiot are you? Every pastor gets these letters shoved in his hand telling how evil all the people are around him. Not Esther. Esther was never combative with the king in her life. All of us have a king in our life. All of us have someone who is more important than anyone else. We need to discern them, protect them. Esther would say, whatever it takes, pay the price. Pay the price. Ruth, would you talk to us, Ruth? The progenitor of the genealogy of Jesus, who married Boaz, and they produced Obed and Jesse and David and Solomon and Jesus. Ruth, tell us about your life. Tell us about your assignment. She would say, do the best wherever you are. If you're in the fields of Boaz, show up early, stay late, because somebody's watching you who is capable of promoting you. There is a little wisdom key that I think very few people ever think about. Somebody is always observing you who is capable of blessing you tremendously. God will never write you a check, but the person who sees your passion, your energy, your integrity. Ruth would tell you, know to whom you are assigned and never leave their side. is a seed that guarantees the multiplication of promotion and blessing. She would say, no matter how it feels in the heat, stay there. I think Ruth would introduce the power of adaptation. Ruth would say no when a season has ended. I believe exit times are critical. Exit times reveal character. There is no revelation like the way you exit your past or an environment. When Ruth realized her time was up, her husband had died, her father-in-law had died, she looks at Naomi and says what? Your people will be my people. Your God will be my God. Wherever you go, I will go. I'm with you. Your decisions are my decisions. Whew. Commitment. I don't like that word. Oh, I don't like that word. It's scary. I admire people. Miss Angie and John are fixing to get married. Whew. I admire people. David and Cindy had their wedding here a few weeks ago. Whew. But commitment is so powerful. Commitment instantly qualifies you for every good thing in that person's future. The moment my brother David accepted Cindy's invitation to be married, had to do that, no. Joke. The moment they decided to be married, the moment he asked Cindy, will you be my wife? The moment she says, I'll go where you go. I'll be what you want me to be. Isn't that a song? Cindy, it's time for you to sing it again to Brother David. Come up here and I want us to sing that song. But the moment, seriously, now, the moment she says yes, she accesses every good thing that will happen in his life. Hallelujah. Half of every dollar he makes is now hers. What you get through commitment, you can't get any other way. John, all the good things that happen in Angie's life, if she wins the lottery, commitment is a powerful thing. Commitment is not loss, it's instant gain. And when Ruth, if Ruth was teaching today, she said, what I told Naomi, I'll go where you go. I'll be where you are. I'm sticking right next to you. Naomi was the golden key to Boaz. Have you ever studied Ruth? Have you ever studied the book of Ruth? Have you ever studied that book? There is not a more powerful book on relationship in Scripture. None. Naomi tells Ruth, the guy who likes you, Boaz, that's where you want to stay. Stay where you see the favor. Stay where you see the favor. Stay where you see favor.